Who remembers what when Abuna goes into the altar after the absolution of the servants? He puts how many spoons of incense in the sharia? Yes, five. Now the key question, ba, five was the easy one. What does it represent? That's a good question. Yes. Okay, no. Who knows from the back? Okay, anybody else? I knew not a lot of people were listening when we were talking about that. Okay. The one thing that... if you have children, if you can use the cry room, please. So the five, it represents five priests in the Old Testament that gave sacrifices that were acceptable. Okay, I gave you the hint. Do you remember who were they? Yes. It was Abel. Okay, remember, there might be a test again. It was Abel, Noah, Melchizedek, Aaron, and Zechariah. And that's, remember, it remembers the five people from the Old Testament that gave sacrifices that were what? Acceptable. Remember, Abel's sacrifice was acceptable sacrifice. Okay? Another thing that I wanted to make sure that we know is that there is two things that we do not sing in the liturgy. Who remembers what are they? That we do not sing. We sing everything else. The gospel is sung. Everything else is sung except two things that are recited. Yes, Ramon. The creed. Very good. And there is something else. Our Father. Very good. Let me ask you something. Have you ever been in class in school when they say, everyone stand up so we can salute the flag and say, I pledge allegiance? Yeah. Well, it's a lot of the people. Okay, let me ask you a question. Have you ever had that happen and they say, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America? Do they say it in secret or do they proclaim it? They proclaim it, right? The same thing with our creed. It bothers me very much when we don't say, proclaim the creed. This is something that we proclaim. We need to stand up and say, we believe in one God, God the Father. And that's, why do we don't sing it? Everyone in the church standing should be reciting and standing up straight. This is what we believe in, and we need to say it out loud. So anytime the creed comes up, or our Father, do you mumble it in your and you do it inaudible? No. What do? Proclaim it. How do you proclaim something? Do you proclaim something inaudible and sing it in the secret? No. So we stand up and we say, we believe in one God, God the Father, the Pantocrator. So this is something really important, okay? I wanted to make sure that you guys understand it. Another thing that I wanted to remind you of is that when we are praying in the liturgy, we should be all praying together. Remember? Did anybody practice what we discussed? Like when the deacon says, raise your hand, just out of curiosity. When the deacon says, pray for the peace of the one only holy, you're praying for that in your mind, or you're still praying for something else? Yes, when the deacon says something, everybody in the church is supposed to pray for that. The deacon says, pray for the peace, you pray for the peace. Deacon says, pray for the Pope, you pray for the Pope. Deacon says, pray for the water, the rivers, and what is everyone praying for? For these things, okay? Because we all to be praying together in one accord. Who conducts the liturgy? Three. Who are the three? Not the woman. Together. We're all together. The priests, the deacon, one deacon inside, or the two deacons, or whoever deacon inside. And who's all the people are outside? And that's the lady, everyone else. In the old days, we said that there was no deacons outside, but now that we do have deacons, it's to be assisting. But not because we have deacons. It says that the congregation do not sing with them. Everyone. This is ours. Like whenever the deacon singing outside, that's supposed to be the congregation. That's supposed to be the lady. That's us. Okay? Everyone outside. Okay? So don't always depend, khalas, the deacon is singing. He ten neprizve. I'm not going to sing. No. You are part of them and we need to be singing together. Okay? and praying together. Is that clear? Another thing that I wanted to also to cover is that you'll notice Abuna's always carrying a cross in his hand. Let me ask you a question. When the bishop is here, does Abuna carry the cross?
No.
No. Why? Yes. Whoever is carrying the cross represents Jesus Christ, because that's how he's the representative, okay, of Jesus Christ. So when the bishop is here, he's the representative. And usually also the celebrant priest is the one that holds. We usually have one cross, and it's usually, like when I was praying in the monastery, it's whoever is the celebrant priest. You know what celebrant priest is? The one, no, not celibate, celebrant. The celebrant priest is the one that prays. You, the trick is praying the institution narrative. When he breaks the bread, he touches the bread, and then the body and everything, and he chooses the lamb. Whoever chooses the lamb at the beginning is the celebrant priest. The other priest does not come or does not touch the lamb. They just pray prayers that do not involve them and the lamb. They just ask, okay? Did you get that? So celebrant priest is the one that handles, that touches the lamb and gives the body. The other priest that assists gives the blood and that's it, okay? So the celebrant priest, we usually in the monastery, we used to use only the celebrant priest's cross. So if Abuna brings his cross, so we always exchange it. So only one priest is carrying the cross, okay? Now let's move on. We touched on last week. Oh, I wanted to ask somebody, 5 loaves and 2 fish. Does anybody remember? What 5 loaves and 2 fish? Yes. No, and I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the liturgy of the word. The liturgy of the word. It has 5? No. 5 breads and 2 loaves. What are they? Got it. He got it. John, the Catholic epistle, the Pauline, the Acts, Synaxarium. Is that a bread? Is that a fish or a bread? Fish, because it's not from the Bible, so we say, so there's 2 fishes. What are the 2 fish? So just let's, no, the 2 fish is the Synaxarium and the sermon, okay? And the 5 bread is, let's go over them again. The Pauline, the Catholic Epistle, Praxis, or the Book of Acts, the Psalm, and the Gospel. That's the 5 loaves, okay? So that constitutes the liturgy of the word, okay? So the liturgy of the word ends at the reconciliation prayer. There are some words that are prayed in the reconciliation prayer that I wanted you to understand. What are we praying for? Have you ever, Abuna always says, let's say it. Cleanse us from all what? Blemish. All blemish, guile, hypocrisy, malice, and the remembrance of evil entailing death. Wanted to ask you something. What is a guile? Have you ever thought about that? Something is bad. Well, yes, we're asking that God protect us from that, so it's probably something bad. What is guile? Huh? Well, that's deceit is one of the things. Deceit is one of them. Let me tell you what it means. You know when somebody is cunning? Somebody is very cunning when they're dealing, or duplicit, you know, like he tells you something and then behind you is something else. Duplicity, like double-faced, you know, or double dealing, or somebody that plays tricks on people. You know that? That's guile. So when Abuna says, cleanse us from all guile, Abuna, we're saying, cleanse us from any things that if we, like, if we do tricks on people that are bad, or if we are showing that we are one face and we are not, like for instance, if somebody comes to church and looks very good and then goes home and talks back to his parents, is that guile or what? Right? Double face, right? Double face. Or if somebody that, comes across that he's doing everything honest in school and then cheats. Double-faced, right? Guile. Okay? So when in the reconciliation prayer, we ask that God cleanse us. You know what cleanse, right? You know what cleanse means? What does cleanse mean? Clean, right? For God to clean us from all guile, all blemish. You know what blemish is, right? Blemish, yeah, and you know how when, like for instance, what blemish is when you come out of the baptism, you're wearing what? White robe, right? And then sometimes we sin a little, then you start beginning getting blemishes. So anything that dirties our robe, any blemish, we ask the Lord cleanse us from that. Okay? So we know guile. Guile is like somebody that plays trick on somebody or double-faced. What about hypocrisy? That's easy too. Hypocrisy? Huh? What is hypocrisy? It's somebody that, yani, insincere. Or he tells you, like for instance, if I come to Carolus and I shake hands with him and I feel like, you know, oh, I show him that everything is fine, but really inside, I say, oh, you know, I wish that something happened to him, or I still hold grudges inside, or a hypocrite, or somebody, you know, when I say something and I really don't mean it. Yeah, Carolus, you look very good today, and I really, oh, I don't think he's. So he's a hypocrite. He's not saying the right thing. He's not saying, he's not being honest in his saying. So we're asking that God protect us or cleanse us from all blemish, guile, hypocrisy, malice. What is malice? Have you ever thought about malice? We're asking God to cleanse us from malice, right? So what is malice? Let's look at what is malice. Malice is when somebody chronically is angry. Very angry. A lot of times angry. Like for instance, he has a lot of hatred inside and evil. And like, you know, even sometimes malice could be somebody it eats him. Like he sleeps. Like I'm picking on a Corollas, okay, whoever, I'm not picking on any Corollas. Corollas does something to me, and I'm sleeping angry about it. I wake up angry about it, and wish that something happens to Corollas. That is malice. You wish, you know, that it's like it's eating you up. You're always thinking of it. And one of the things that I found out is that really helps. Have anybody had that happen to them, like a friend at school or something? And you're always thinking about, they did something to you, and you're always thinking, I wish that he did this and this, how dare he does that to me. Have anybody have that in school? And you're always thinking about it? The best thing is pray for that person and approach that person and talk to him. Okay? In loving way. And you'll find that all that hatred that you have inside, and do it lovingly. Okay? It's all gonna melt away. Okay? So if you have somebody that's bothering you, and that's what we said. We said that before approaching to take communion, what are we supposed to do? Reconcile with everyone, right? So here we're praying that God cleanse us from all these things. If you have hatred against. And then the last thing was what? The remembrance of evil entailing death. You know, our fathers calls this the sins of memory. The sins of memory. And what ends up happening is that, say sometimes, I had a fight with Carolus Bardo. And then I made up with him. And then I went and I confessed the sin. And then one day I'm sitting on the couch. And then I remember the fight. And then my mind makes it bigger. Oh, he did this, he did that. And that's remembering the evil and not only that, but you start adding features. Your memory starts adding features to the fight. He did this, now he did this, and how dare he did, and then he said this. And that's the remembering of evil entailing death. And this is one of the worst things, because it can lead to death. And that's one of it's called the sins of the memory. And it's very important that you try and you pray that you stop, you know, that when you remember these things, you remember the reconciliation and you do the sign of the cross and you walk away, you don't continue. Don't play that movie in your mind again. Oh yes, he did this and he did that and he did, and I said this. No, cut it from the beginning. Don't fall in that trap. And here we're asking the remembrance of evil entailing death, because it could lead you to death, because it eats you up. It eats you up. So we need to clean everything. And once we clean everything, reconcile everything among us, Then what do we sing? Hitena prizveya. What is hitena prizveya? Through the intercession of the Mother of God, O Lord, grant us the forgiveness of our sins. So here we reconciled with each other, and now we're asking God that we reconcile with Him. Through the, okay, do you get that? We ask the forgiveness of our sins. And then the deacon says, kiss one another, each other, and so on. In the old days, I remember when we were talking about the anaphora. In the old days, right before the offer, the deacon says, offer, offer, offer. This is when the lady brings the offering. Do you remember when we were talking about that? That's the beginning of the anaphora. But now, we say, hiten neprezveya all the way to the end. And the deacon says kiss one another with a holy kiss, and he says, "O Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy on us." And then he says, "Offer and offer," and we move on. Right after that, that's the end of the liturgy of the word. What starts after that? Do you remember the three parts that we talked about? What's after the liturgy of the word? The liturgy of the faithful. The liturgy of the faithful is divided. This is new stuff, okay? And the little part that we had. That. So the liturgy of the faithful is divided into four parts, okay? And it's just similar or exactly like the Last Supper, okay? What happened in the Last Supper? If you read it, and you can read that in St. Paul said it in 1 Corinthians 15. It says that the Lord gave thanks, blessed, broke, and gave to the disciples. And the liturgy of the faithful, it's exactly like this. It's divided into how many parts? Four parts. The first one was giving thanks. And where is the giving thanks? That's the anaphora or anaphora. We refer to it the anaphora, okay? That's the giving thanks portion. And then after that, it's the blessing. Remember, he gave thanks, blessed, and broke the bread, and then gave to his disciples. So the same thing with the liturgy of the word. It's the anaphora, institution narrative. That's when Abuna says he blessed it, he sanctified it. Okay, that part. We're going to go into little details next week on that. And then the breaking of the bread, that's the fraction. Remember, you know the fraction when every time Abuna stops, we say, Kyrie eleison, Kyrie eleison, Lord, have mercy. The fraction. And then at the last part, you know how he gave to the disciples? What does Abuna do? He gives us communion. So the liturgy of the faithful is divided into four parts. The first one is what? Anaphora. And then institution narrative, fraction, and communion. Very good. So let's just really go fast. The anaphora. The anaphora, if you guys have your cholegis, if you have a cholegi, you can open it real fast. I wanted you to look through it because it's really important. It's the anaphora or anaphora is divided into two parts. Two parts. I don't want to mix you up with all the parts, but okay, the liturgy of the faithful is divided into how many parts? Four. And the anaphora, institution narrative, the fraction, and the communion. The anaphora is divided, it's two parts, okay? The first part, if you open, you'll see what it talks about. It starts by, the Lord be with you all, okay? And then he tells the people, lifts up your heart, and then he says, we have them with the Lord, and then because of that, let us give thanks. This is the giving thanks portion, remember? It's the first portion of it's giving thanks. So let us give thanks to the Lord. And then the people say, it is meet and right. When the people say, it is meet and right, they agree with Abuna that God is worthy. Meet means worthy, okay? I always think of what does meet mean? Meet means worthy. So we say, yes, he is worthy and right. And once he hears that from the people, Abuna starts say, yes, meet and right, meet and right. Truly, indeed, he is meet and right or worthy and right. And then we start the liturgy of the faithful. Everybody reconciled. We reconciled with God. We believe that he is worthy and right. And then we start the anaphora. Okay? And we said the anaphora is divided into how many parts? Two parts. The first part, basically, we give thanks to God for creating us. Okay? Hold on. We give thanks to God for creating us. And the second part of the anaphora, we thank Him for saving us. Okay? So the first part of the anaphora, we thank Him for creating us. And why do we? How do we say that? We start by, Abuna starts saying at the beginning, how did He create us? Who has created the heaven, the earth? It's page 185, by the way. And he starts by saying, oh, you the being master, Lord God of truth, being before the ages and reigning forever, dwells in the highest, looks upon the lowly. And He created, so we are thanking Him for creating us, okay? He created the heavens, the earth, the sea, and all that is therein. And then He created what else? The visible and an invisible. What are the invisibles, by the way? Angels. Do you know how, huh? The Holy Spirit? Well, He didn't create, no. Holy Spirit always existed. It was not created. But the invisible, like somebody said, angels. Do you know how many ranks of heavenly orders are there? Seven ranks of order. Okay, there is seven archangels. There is nine. Mu said nine. Good, okay. So there are seven angels, archangels, okay? But there are nine heavenly orders. And we say them right here afterwards. The first one is the angels. And then the archangels. And then the principalities, the thrones, the dominions, the powers. Did we get all nine? There's two left. And then we afterwards, after the deacon says, you who are seated stand, Abuna starts mentioning the other two, which are the cherubim and the seraphim. These are the nine heavenly orders, or heavenly orders. Okay? Get it? So now you know why is Abuna saying all this. So we're thanking Him for creating everything, the visible and invisible, and then we start talking about the nine heavenly orders, which are what again? That's the same again. The angels, archangels, principalities, thrones, dominions, powers, cherubim, seraphim. Okay? When the deacon says, who you are seated, stand. You need to stand up. If you're sitting, if you're tired, you should be standing up at that time. Okay? Why? It's because we are being with the angels in front of the throne of God. Can you imagine in front of the throne of God and an angel is sitting down? Angel, very tired. He did a lot of things. Can you imagine something like this? Or are they all standing up? Put your hands forward. They're all standing up. And they're all singing, right? Do you see an angel saying, holy, holy? No. They're all singing, holy, holy, holy is the Lamb. So He is telling you, guys, get up. If you're sitting, sit up, get up. Because now we're going to sing. We're about to sing with the angels. And then Abuna starts describing the cherubim with six eyes and the seraphim with six wings, praising continuously. And once he says praising continuously, the deacon say, let us attend. And what do the people sing? The cherubim. So we are actually singing with the angels. And what are the angels saying? Holy, holy, holy. And what are we singing? Holy, holy, holy. So we are singing with the angels. You have to understand is that we are going to be standing in front of the throne and we need to be all singing. We need to proclaim His death, proclaim His resurrection, proclaim His ascension. And we said something about proclamation. Do we proclaim it inaudible or proclaim it audible? So the same thing with here. I want to hear everybody in the church standing up with the angels, The cherubim worship you. The seraphim glorify you. And we also praise you and we say, holy, holy, holy. Okay? Do you understand that? So it's very important that you start thinking that way, that you start standing up and you're singing with the angels when we say, when we're praying that. And then he tells you, look towards the east. Why is that? What's the east? What's going on in the east? He's coming again in the east. Do you know where the Garden of Eden was? Was in the east. The Garden of Eden was on the was in the east. So what do we, what does that mean when we say, when the deacon says, look toward the east? He's telling you, look where you were and thrive to go back to where you were. Where when Adam was in the Garden of Eden, he was not doing a lot of sins. He was not sinning, right? So the same thing with us, when you start thinking, I want to go back to the Garden of Eden. I want to be good, and I can't wait to go back to heaven. Do you see that? So look towards it. Look forward to where Jesus, actually Jesus promised he was going to be coming back from the east. So this is something, you know, don't just stand up and look, oh, where is the east? And then the east is this way, and look. So there is more to it than that. I want you to start thinking of the heavenly thoughts, okay? So what are we agreeing on? What are the things that we agree on, we're going to agree on to pray tomorrow, when we're praying tomorrow? When we look towards the east, we would look at how, where we were before in the Garden of Eden, and also look for the resurrection, because that's when Jesus said he was going to come back and take us back home. So what else? To be standing, okay? And what else? What else? There was something about proclamation. Huh? Let us attend. No, there is a proclamation. The creed, and what do we say that? Do we proclaim it inaudible or audible? Standing up, very loud, just like we proclaim a lot of other things that we proclaim, even when it comes to school and stuff like that. Okay? So this is basically the anaphora, and we're going to go really fast next time into what's next after the anaphora? Institute of narrative. Fraction. It's very easy from here on. But I hope that in light of what we're talking about, you start looking at things. Okay? Abuna's walking around the church with his sharia. What is he doing? Do you see him as a mailman waiting for picking? Did anybody actually ever try that? Have a paper? You did? Very good. So collecting your prayers, collecting. So I want you to start practicing these things and look at the spiritual things. Okay? It's very important that you start thinking of that. I wanted to ask you, actually, well, last week I was we said that in the liturgy of the word, what does Abuna usually face? The liturgy of the word, where is Jesus? Where do we see God? Where is God transfigured for us? Huh? Okay. Hold on. No. Agbeya, where do we the people, God sees, that's the assembly. Okay? Then the liturgy of the word. Where? The word. And that's why Abuna, a lot of times, during that liturgy of the word, he's looking at the podium and he's giving incense. When the deacon is, or somebody is reading the gospel, you'll find Abuna looking and praying an inaudible prayer, looking at the podium. Do you know what is he praying for? He's praying for the peace. He's praying for everything. The peace of the church, the catechumens, the water of the rivers, the Pope, all the prayers. It's like two pages, and you can actually see it in here in your Bible. And he prays, and he's facing, because we see God in the word, in that portion, in the liturgy of the word. The liturgy of the faithful, where do we see God? In the communion, okay? So I want you to start thinking of these things and start knowing the heavenly parts that we're talking about and envisioning them and see them in the liturgy. And it will mean a lot more. The liturgy will be much more enjoyable and it will mean much more to you. That's how it's meant to be. So tomorrow when we're saying the cherubim worship you, I want you to start thinking, oh, you're imagining all the you're with the angels saying that. Okay? Get it? So I want you to start thinking of these things. And start praying, God cleanse us from all And then you start thinking, oh yes, I did this, I did that. Start, Lord, cleanse me from all these things. Reconcile with your brother and your sister and all that. Okay? Anyone have any questions? Okay. You have a question? Okay, let's stand up to pray.